you.
Hey, it's me, the mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart. Hey, check out my new tag team, baby, Monty and the Pharaoh.
Hey, Jimmy, don't forget to tell them about Long Island's number one pro wrestling broadcast.
Well, you know what, I would, but you already did it.
Monty and the Pharaoh.
The Monty and Pharaoh Show.
Monty and Pharaoh, bro.
Monty and the Pharaoh.
The Monty and the Pharaoh.
You've got the future Hall of Famer, that rocker, Marty Jannetty, MJ in the house, and I'm sitting here with two more future Hall of Famers, Monty and the Pharaoh. We're doing that stuff and we're gonna rock it.
Monty and the Pharaoh.
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 And Monty and the Pharaoh. Oh, is it Monty and the Pharaoh?
Yeah. Monty and the Pharaoh.
Monty and the Pharaoh.
Hey, cut music. When you want the best in professional wrestling, Long Island, there's only one place you're going to get it, right here.
Monty and the Pharaoh. Now, that's not just the coolest, and that's not just the best. That, my friends, is just incredible.
Monty and the Pharaoh. Duh.
I'm having a wonderful time with Monty and the Pharaoh, and I'm going to put him in a cross face chicken, and he's going to go down right now. Yeah.
Hey! Nikita Koloff, the Russian Nightmare! And you're watching the number one show on Long Island with Monty and the Pharaoh.
They didn't pay the guy.
Okay.
They put a belt on him, and the guy stayed. Oh, I'm the champion!
All right, welcome back to Long Island's number one pro wrestling broadcast, Monty and the Pharaoh, only seen here out of Indie Music TV in Long Island, where we have a special guest, our honor. We are humbled to have the former NWA champion and pro wrestling legend, Mr. Ronnie Garvin.
Oh, yeah, brother. Yeah.
How are we doing there, Rugged Ronnie, or is it Hands of Stone?
I like Hands of Stone.
Yeah. Whichever you prefer. Oh. I have so many nicknames. I started the first 10 years, they called me One Man Gang. For 10 years, yeah, the beginning of my career.
Okay.
And then I had the name of Rugged DN, and it was courtesy of Vince McMahon. Before that, I was Hands of Stone.
And that was courtesy of?
That was, what was the announcer?
That Gordon Solie?
Gordon Solie.
Oh, boy, well, he gets nicknames from Vince McMahon and Gordon Solie.
That's what I'm talking about.
You really know your history.
There you go.
Financially independent. Don't have to be very rich, but just enough to live for a year or two when I've been employed. Yeah, you could afford to do it. Because there was a lot of promoters that were a little bit shady. You know, not too many, but there was just a few too many.
Yeah, well.
And the word gets out, and they promise you the world, and then when you got there, it was not like today where you got contracts and everything is asked to be legal. In the old days, it was a handshake, or my word is good. And their word was not good. So I told quite a few of them where to go. And, you know, guess what? 7-8 years later, they call you. Oh, we'd like to have you. And put it down on paper.
Well, how do you get over those feelings, though, right? So someone really screws you over, you leave, and then they call you back. Like, is it hard to get over that, or is it just business? All right, well, you know.
No, I treat them like
Oh, you can say that.
I tell them eat and die.
There you go.
Good for you.
There you go. You know,
but, you know... prime example, Crockett and I, we had a big dispute, and I was back there, and I was the world's champion like 7 years later. You know, they were wrong, and a lot of times people recognize, you know, they screwed me over some deal I had, and it was part of the, George Scott was the booker, and he was not a good guy, not to me anyway. So, you know, everything turns out okay. If you know what your work. And they don't have anything to throw back at you. Like, you were late, you were drunk, you was on drugs, you got arrested. No, I did my job.
Right.
I showed up on time.
Right.
And I put out 100%. So that way, you know, they can't come back at you with anything.
Did you find Vince McMahon Jr.'s word or slash integrity as your booker when you worked for him? Did you find him to actually be more honest than some of these other promoters?
Oh, I think so.
Yeah. Very interesting, because all the time, all we ever hear is this Vince was evil and he's this, but he's more honest than some of the guys you dealt with.
Yes, sir.
There you go.
I never had a problem, and I'll tell you what, I respect him because the man had a vision about this profession, wrestling. And we had promoters that have been promoting for like 40, 50 years that didn't want to change. And like it or not, the world changes, you know.
Sure.
It might be going too fast changing for my liking.
Sure.
But, you know, he had a vision, and he's obviously a very smart man. He's a billionaire.
Well, did you find him to be ruthless? Like, you know, you hear all these wrestling experts go, this ruthless corporation, or even talking about this whole Mickey James situation. Oh, my God, they treat these wrestlers bad, or is it Vince was a businessman?
Well, you have a choice. You take the job or you don't.
Imagine that concept. I mean,
wow. Wow.
Who runs your life but you?
Right.
You know?
Right.
And you complain?
Sorry.
You know, but most people that complain usually is the people that blew their money away.
Mm.
They were making big bucks, and they went crazy, partying and drugs and you name it. And then at the end of their career, now they're sour.
Right.
Because they're broke.
Right.
Or near broke or whatever. And I never had that problem.
Does Vince owe these, well, I'll use one name, Superstar Billy Graham, right?
He created those guys. He created them. Hulk Hogan, he created them. I was in the NWA, but the promoters didn't know what to do with them. They said, well, go see McMahon.
Whoops. That's what they did, send you.
Look what they lost. Look what they lost.
Yeah?
If they would have had any idea
about
what to do with them.
Yep.
You know, the guy had a physique. Good talker.
Oh, yeah.
Well, looked great.
Sure.
You know, might not have been the best wrestler, but look at the career.
Right.
What's more important, mic skills or mat skills?
Ooh.
I think you need both.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I was not that good on the mic, but I think I produced in the ring. And, you know, and on the size, too.
Right.
That's why I stayed in shape.
Right.
You know? If you start to grow a belly, you're not going to go very far in wrestling.
Well, I don't know about that nowadays. Well, now some of them have bellies and do cartwheels. I can't anymore.
Good.
You know, by the way, speaking of wrestling vision, when did it all start for the Hands of Stone's vision? How do you become a wrestler? When does it first pop into your head? How does it all start for you?
My aunt took me to a wrestling match way, way back in Canada, Montreal Forum.
Nice.
And I liked it. I was 13 years old, and at 15, I went to a gym and started learning and working out. At 17, I was heading for Boston.
So you knew?
Told everybody back then I was 19.
So you knew? First time you watched it? Or, you know, basically what you're in, like, I want to do this?
Well, I played a little hockey, but you had to be a super... There was so many hockey players in Canada.
Yes, you think?
Know, what kind of living would I make? Unless I was a super, you know, hockey player. But I wasn't. You know, I was a slow guy. I played defense, and there was no way I was going to go anywhere in hockey.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and then in wrestling, well, everything depends on you. It's not a teamwork. That's why I never liked tag team too much. You know, it was okay. I tag team with some of the guys I really like, but I want everything to depend on me. If I fail, who do you blame? You know, if you're in a team, you want to blame the others.
You won a lot of belts not liking it, though. I'll tell you that. I was reading your resume last night. That's a lot of tag titles, too.
Yeah, tag titles, singles, and yeah.
Sure.
Well, you know, sometimes the problem is your partner. It's not you. But all the partners I had were good, so I had to do my part. I had good partners. I had Barry Windham and guys like that, you know. Tiger Conway Jr., I forgot.
Terry Garvin was all over that.
Terry Garvin, yeah,
was
that's
all
how
over
I started.
That list.
Terry had wrestled amateur in Canada.
Well, speaking of Terry Garvin, right? Everybody's aware of that whole Ring Boy scandal thing.
Oh, yeah.
Did you foresee problems with Terry with this type of situation, or what were your feelings about that whole thing when you were hearing about
that? That had to weird you out a little bit.
Terry was like that. He was one of the biggest ribber. He would joke with people. He would do all kinds. And everybody knew he was. He was good. So was Pat Patterson, even in the 70s.
There's no secret behind the scenes.
They weren't embarrassed about it, and that's their life.
Right.
You know, right. I don't interfere with people's life. Your choice is your choice.
Right.
As long as it ain't mine.
Do you ever see anything suspicious with the, you know, like any weirdness or with the young kids, you know, setting up the ring at the time zone, you know?
But he would joke with them. And back then, people had a phobia. I get, oh, he's gay. Well, you know, he didn't attack anybody.
Right.
Not that I know of. Okay. I was his partner for quite a few years. You know, and we never went to the same places. Nighttime, he was gone all night long. You know, I don't know where he went. Didn't care.
Mm.
I didn't live with the guy.
Right.
I traveled with him. You know, and he was a fun guy. You know, he loved to joke.
Well, so speaking of that, right, you lived a pretty clean life, right? And you've been around some guys that haven't lived such a clean life. And I would assume, just like a regular life, do some bad things. How hard is it to, like, separate business when you don't agree with what someone's doing?
I'm not involved as long as they don't interfere with my life. If it interferes with my life, I'll speak out, you know. But what people do in their private life, I couldn't care less.
You just stayed out of it, basically.
Live and let live.
It's the old saying, we don't swim in your toilet, don't pee in my pool. Right?
I like that.
What?
That's copyright, Ron. You can't take it.
When we did interviews, everything was from here.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't scripted. It wasn't somebody wrote it for you. I couldn't do that. Yeah. That's why I don't think I'd make a good actor. Following the script.
What was it like working with the Poffos, you know, back in the ICW days?
It was interesting.
Are they on camera or off screen? Because if so,
They were different kind of people than I was used to. I mean, everybody has their own way, but Angelo Poffo was a different animal. I've never been around people like that, where money was their god.
Really?
Absolute god.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Okay.
Especially Angelo. And Randy, Lanny was happy-go-lucky guy, nice guy. I just watched the way they operated. And, you know, better rich and dead than poor and alive. I heard that every day. Every day.
It was almost like a prayer. Wow.
And I said, that don't make no sense. Better rich and dead than poor and alive. Poor people have a great time sometimes.
It's true.
You know, they drink moonshine, they party, you know, they smoke a joint, you know.
A couple of aspirin in the morning, interview Rugged Ronnie here. Wait a minute, what am I saying?
And if you were poor, they didn't have any respect for you. There was a few wrestlers, you know, they knew they were broke, and they just, you know, they didn't have no respect.
Did you see the potential in Macho Man Randy Savage back in those days?
I didn't think he'd go that far. He was very
interesting.
He's a talented guy.
Oh, very talented.
You know, and but he was like that in life, 24 hours a day.
He was paranoid.
I think. I might be wrong. I'm not a psychiatrist.
So he was wound up like an alarm clock.
A couple of times I would do something, you know, nice or something. What are you doing that for? You know, he was always on the lookout for. I never understood.
So he was paranoid, like everybody said. I think so.
This is before Elizabeth,
isn't it? Wow.
But yeah, the only real fight I had in wrestling was with him.
Do tell.
Yeah.
What happened then?
Well, it didn't last very long.
What caused it? What?
I was wrestling for Jim Crockett.
Okay.
And they just came in, him and Angelo and Leaping Lanny, into the promotion. And I didn't know them. I had heard of them, but I didn't know them. So I'm booked to wrestle in Columbia, South Carolina. And my partner was Tiger Conway Jr. And I go way back, you know. The guy's a nice guy. I used to know his dad, you know, nice family. And so we get in the ring, and I knew something was wrong, you know. There was something going on with the Poffos against him.
Okay.
And, you know, if you're my partner, I'm going to stick with you.
Sure.
I ain't leaving you.
Sure.
So during the match, man, it was cussing. I mean, it was, you know.
Real shots being thrown?
Yeah, it wasn't going real well.
Okay.
And anyway, at the end it happened. They were going to jump him, you know. And so I got involved. And as I was walking around the ring, keeping Lanny at bay, because it was one-on-one at that point, you know. And Lanny was kicking at me and everything, but he was keeping his distance, you know. And I didn't want to hurt Lanny or really get in a fight with him.
So Lanny was like half-hearted into this whole situation?
Well, when I got around the ring, Randy was on top of Tiger.
Okay.
And they put a rope around the ring on those pedestal things.
Sure.
Concrete bottom.
Sure.
I picked that up, and that was the end of the fight.
Jeez. So,
well.
Ow.
Some people got hurt in the process, in the schmals, you know.
And that
at ringside. You know.
Wow.
Well, not hurt bad, but maybe their ankles.
Yeah.
You know, they got, you know.
So. Victim of circumstance.
But anyway, I got all the blame.
There you go. You know.
So that's when I left the promotion, which I didn't care. You know, I was wrestling the next day somewhere.
You mentioned Jim Crockett. We lost him recently.
Yeah.
Can you share your feelings on Jim Crockett Jr.?
Jim was a good guy, but he was, you know, I think he was a little bit gullible when it come to Dusty controlling everything.
Mm.
And Flair, you know, they would really take advantage of him, I think. They convinced him to buy jets, airplane, you know. And all the things that we're doing and promoting, you know. And but Jimmy even bought Dusty a brand new Mercedes, sports one, you know. He was mesmerized with him. And, you know, the guy was booking cards with 30, 40 guys on it. I mean, come on. You know, it's not quantity of matches. It's the quality of the matches.
So if you watch these wrestling documentaries, right,
yeah.
And they have Rhodes on there or Flair, they're like, if Crockett just would have stayed in the Carolinas, we'd have been fine. But you're saying they're part of the reason this all happened.
Yes. Yes. Well, and that's why Dusty wind up wrestling up here with Polka Dots. Because he used to knock Vince on every interview we did in NWA.
Sure.
He always put a dig. And Vince is a genius.
Right.
He put polka dots on him.
And then and there's a bodyguard named Virgil. Big bang! Don't screw at me, Dusty!
I picked up on it so fast, I said, my God. Because I didn't know Vince.
Right.
You know, I never talked to him for long, long periods of time. You know, it was just small talks. And I said, what a genius. Instead of the old promoters, the NWA promoters would have told him to go screw himself.
Mm.
Vince, no. You made money with him.
Mm.
And Dusty made money, but Vince made money.
But then he also ruined his career so he could go nowhere else because he was the one wearing polka dots.
Go from the American dream to a polka dot man.
With sapphire. Does Dusty Rhodes get a free pass? What I mean by this is Hulk Hogan always gets murdered on the internet for being selfish and self-serving, and he didn't put this guy over, and he didn't put that guy over. But it sounds to me like before Dusty got to Vince McMahon, when he was doing his NWA thing, that behind the scenes, he was pretty self-serving. He was pretty selfish.
I've known Dusty. We traveled to Rhodes early in the 69 or 70, 68, 69, in Florida. Him and Dick Murdoch were there. And they're a little bit younger than me. And I was driving them around. Well, I mean, they rode with me. They liked to ride with me because I drove pretty fast. And I didn't mind if they drank beer. And they were nice guys. But when he became a booker and involved in the promotion, that's when he changed. You know, I don't hate him. I just, you know, I saw a lot of stuff he was doing.
Yeah.
And I don't think it was right.
So personal feelings aside, was he ruthless? He was ruthless behind the scenes.
That's one thing I put out of my mind. If I don't like somebody, I ignore them. I don't hate them.
I just
pretend they don't exist.
How did you ignore the polka dots later on? That had to be rough.
that's a hard thing to ignore.
Well, how can you just close my eyes?
here's one thing you couldn't close your eyes on. What was your relationship like with Andre the Giant?
Oh, great. What a guy.
Okay.
I wrestled him.
Okay.
I beat him in Knoxville, Tennessee, 1978.
Wait a minute. You beat Andre the Giant?
Yeah.
What's his story?
You can look it up.
Wow. I thought I did my homework. No, actually, I was aware of it, but please tell us the details.
I got videos, but never of the ending. That was a no-no.
So it was a tag match?
No. Yeah, no. It was a handicap.
He had
a partner, and I was,
Wait, Andre had a partner against you.
Yep.
Against you?
Yeah. But
who was the partner?
His partner was Welsh. What was his name? Roy Lee Welsh.
Okay.
I had broken Roy Lee Welsh's hand. Yeah. He was in a cast. So he was a partner with a hand in a cast, which he didn't come in the ring. You know, what happened is he challenged me. I wrestle anybody. And that's when I was the one-man gang.
And he sprang Andre
on
you.
I was the one-man gang.
That's pretty cool.
And I said, I'll wrestle anybody, Superman, anybody. So they tricked me on TV to sign a contract. And then when I find out it was Andre the Giant, oh, my God, you guys going to kill me. And I said, well, I'll do it in one condition. I says, he has a partner. It has to be booked as a handicap match. Andre the Giant and Roy Lee Welsh against Ronnie Garvin. And that's how they booked the show. It was sold out in Knoxville, you know. And he was a hell of a guy.
So you pinned Roy then?
Well, actually, I pinned him, and he got disqualified as the referee counted three. He pushed me so high, I went over the top rope, and he got DQ'd. But I got highlights of the match when he's down and I'm coming off the top rope on him and I'm beating the hell out of him. I hit him over the head with a chair. I was a one-man gang, so I was trying to kill the giant. You know, sure. I used to tell the guys, you know, you're 6'6", and if I'm 5'10" or 5'11", when we're laying on our back, we're the same height. And that's the object of wrestling, you know, to pin somebody.
Right.
So you're no taller than I am, you know. And when you got a big guy and you take him off his feet and he's down, makes you look like a giant. It does.
So at the time where they give you the NWA strap, was... Now, Jimmy Garvin was your stepson, right?
Yeah.
As your stepson. Yeah. Was Jimmy supposed to win the belt, or was it always planned to give you the title?
Wow.
I don't know. I don't think so.
Right.
I don't think so.
How did you end up getting the strap then? How was that decision made?
That's what they wanted. That's what they wanted. You know,
forgive me, though. Were you 42 at the time that you got the strap?
Yeah.
Wow. Were you surprised when they came to you with that?
What they did is, I kind of figured it out. I beat all the four horsemen.
Oh.
And, I was the one man gang, Hands of Stone. And, you know, so I'd have matches, man. They'd send two. They'd come in one after another. Man, I'd beat the heck out of everybody. Mm. And, you know, I was getting over. I was, you know. And I guess they decided, I think they wanted to give it to Magnum, but he had that accident, you know. And so, you know, that was their decision, not mine.
You had to be pleased as well as surprised.
Belts didn't mean a whole lot to me.
Okay.
Was money. You know,
about that belt?
You can give me $20 payoff and put all the belts you want. They did that in the old days.
Okay.
They didn't pay the guy.
Okay.
They put a belt on him, and the guy stayed. Oh, I'm the champion.
Honey, when you were in Puerto Rico, what were your thoughts on Colon and the Bruiser Brody murder?
Oh. Well, I went there and I benefited from that because they boycotted. You know,
people didn't want to go there.
I have been there way, way before that. And I always liked Carl, you know. I knew him for a long time. And I didn't have a beef with anybody. And I think it happened was between two guys. I wasn't there, but, you know. And Brody, I love the guy. He flew with me quite a bit. You know, I traveled with him. But he was pushy. He was a pushy guy, which a lot of guys are.
He was clearly headstrong.
Probably guilty of that myself. Okay. And the guy that stabbed him had lost two little girls,
right,
drowning.
Right.
So he might have been a little bit. And Brody probably said, hey, I'm not going to do this. This is the way it's going to go, blah, 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 blah. And probably had a little verbal argument.
Mm.
And the guy came back in with a towel around his hand. And I wasn't there, but that's what I hear.
Your thoughts when you heard the news?
I thought it was horrible.
Devastated?
But he was a small guy.
Mm.
And maybe he was threatening.
Mm.
I'm not justifying anything,
instance.
You know, because he never went to jail.
Right.
And
right.
Murder is murder.
Yeah.
I wrestled Abdullah three or four different times.
Down in Puerto Rico?
No, in Puerto Rico, I think I did once. And then other places, I can't remember what town.
Was it a bloodbath?
Oh, yeah. You were all over the building.
See what I'm doing.
You did a tour of the building, you know, upstairs, downstairs, around, in the bathroom.
Right, right. There's a great hot dog stand by the bathroom on the second level. Let's go over there, grab something to eat.
Sure.
Your legacy, of course, mostly sits, obviously, with the NWA, former world champion, all the days through the territories, dominating.
What was it like when you finally got to the WWF? I mean, was it like you're known today as the WWE? Was that like culture shock? I mean, how different was it?
It was. I got there, and after I got there, I said, what do I do? I'm surrounded with monsters. There's more gimmicks going on and angles, and I mean, you know, and the whole idea of the business is to get on pay-per-view. You know, that's where the big money was, pay-per-view, and that was new to me. You know, I think we had a couple, I think, with Crockett. It was just the beginning of it, you know. And, of course, it didn't take a genius to figure that out. That's what you got to get on. And I said, man, you get lost here. You know, how do you stand out? So I looked at Greg, you know, and I like Greg. I mean, Valentine. And I talked to him. And I said, you know, you want to work with me? And he's my style. I mean, we beat the dog out of each other. Yeah. You know. And one thing about Flair, I did the same thing with Flair, and he never complained, you know. And I respected that.
So you do have hands of stone for real.
I'm not the only one.
Yeah, I'm sure. I'm sure.
So,
ow.
So I run something by him about, you know, and the whole thing was my idea. You know, wind up a referee and losing and come back.
Yeah, you
and,
shafted him.
Well.
Yeah, really bad.
But
go on.
I'd done that in the past. You know, I'd done that 3 or 4 times in the past. But every time I lost and lose or leave, I'd come back with a mask. I was Mr. Knoxville. I was Mr. Fort Myers. I was Mr. Ugali. I was Mr. You know. And I would wrestle with my boots, with my initials, RG. So the commentator would say, I think you're Ronnie Garvin. You got RG on your boots.
That's funny.
And I would say, no. This means a rugged grappler. You know, rough grappler. And, really? You know, and so I said, well, let's change it. You know, I'll come back as a referee. I'll go get a license. Anybody can be a referee, you know. But providing you have a license up north, in the south, you don't need a license. So that's what I did. And then I was in his time, you know. I mean,
oh, yeah.
Just drive him crazy.
Yep.
You know, and, you know, it got
over. You retired my favorite wrestler back then. Thanks a lot.
It got over. You know, and we had some hell of a matches.
There's a lot of wrestling experts out there always pushing for a union.
Oh, that's the worst thing that can happen.
Why?
Please explain.
Why? I mean, you're a grown-up human being, a wrestler with muscles this big, some of them, you know, and they can't do their own deals. They can't talk. They can talk on TV. Well, go to the promoter and tell him what you want. And if he doesn't want to give it to you, we'll go somewhere else. It's that simple. You're not forced to do anything. You know, it's like when they try to blame Vince for the drugs, you know. I didn't do drugs. You know, there was a problem. It's an individual problem.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no way a promoter's going to know what you're doing in your private life. You know, and unions is the same way. Unions is a way to get, who makes the most money out of that?
The union.
Union. Yeah. Right.